Let's wait some more time to let people in. Should we start? What do you think? Not many people coming in right now. Yeah. Okay, let's go. Okay, good evening to all participants. I'm Miguel Telles, FGA's Executive Vice President, and it's my pleasure to welcome you all to this webinar organized together with our friends from LTP Labs. We'll be trying to cover accelerating analytics to improve operations planning. And we believe that in difficult times like these, it's important for FGA to bring to discussion with our associates and friends opportunities which we believe are relevant to the current context and will help shape the near future of our processes and organizations. By doing so, we'd like to contribute for a more positive outlook, adding confidence to the general economy. Today's webinar will try to bring some light into the opportunity of diving into analytics. How much do we actually use analytics? How much do we look and use the information that's already within our organizations, and it's there for free, and it's open for us to use. In a world where data keeps flowing and demand for customization is increasingly higher, jargons like mass customization are now pretty much common, and the pace of change is growing faster and faster. Now, organizations are pushed to adopt necessarily data-driven culture to help them and support them in the decision-making process. This is why we felt the discussion with LTP Labs could be very useful, since they're known for their expertise in the matter of analytics. I'd like to thank Luis Guimarães and Daniel Pereira for their availability and their time, and very quickly try to introduce them. Luis is a co-founder and partner at LTP Labs. He's a professor at the Department of Industrial Engineering and Management in the Faculty of Engineering in Porto. He's worked across several industries, such as retail, consumer goods, process industries, being involved in projects whose challenges range from demand forecasting and production planning to asset management. He's been responsible for several projects which transformed the sales and operations planning in variety of sectors, bridging advanced analytics with impactful planning capabilities and processes. He holds a PhD in industrial engineering and management from the Porto University. Daniel is a manager at LTP Labs. He's worked in several projects in retails, process industries, manufacturing, with an emphasis on supply chain and operations planning. His main area of expertise is sales and operations. He holds a master's degree in industrial engineering by FIOP, and he's currently attending the doctoral program in industrial engineering, also in FIOP. He's previously worked as a consultant for Kaizen. And before handing it over to you, I'd just like to add that at the end of the session, we'll have time for some questions, which you may place using the chat button in Zoom. And also, please bear in mind that this webinar is being recorded. And with no further delays, I would hand it over to you, Louise and Danielle, and the floor is yours. And I'll try to interrupt you as little as possible.
Thank you, Miguel. First, I would like to take this opportunity to thank Apjai for their support in organizing this webinar, and to Miguel for moderating this session. So what we are going to see today is so both topics that we are going to cover, both analytics and operations planning, are not themes that are new, but what we would like during this webinar is to highlight the fact that much can still be done by better exploring the synergies between these two teams. So on one end, we have seen recently that many companies are investing in increasing their capabilities in terms of analytics. So by hiring more specialized people in the area, by increasing the way their process adopts this type of techniques, and also by improving the type of methods that they use to plan their operations. Yet, in many cases still, the analytics is being as a competitive advantage. In fact, the COVID-19 also increased the awareness for this topic, because even though the subject has been around for quite some time, many of the established decision processes were based on assumptions that during this pandemic didn't hold. So companies need new ways of trying to plan their operations, and these new ways can capitalize on analytics. If this is true from the analytics point of view, if we look at operations planning, this has been a topic that has long been addressed by companies. So companies need to plan their operations, but sometimes the issues happen during these plans. And these issues often lead to significant consequences. Even though nowadays we are more sensible to this theme, and you can see on the right hand side a couple of examples of supply chains that have been disrupted by the pandemics because they couldn't get parts for manufacturing, for instance, in the case of Fiat Chrysler Automobiles, or because the closing of operations in some countries affected the entire supply chain and so on, or even Nestlé, that faced a surge in demand during this pandemic and could not fulfill this surge due to the limitation in their capacity. Even though we are more sensitive to this topic in the supply chain, so this is not recent news. So this has been around for quite some time. And all the examples in the left, they date from the previous to the COVID-19. So, and you can see that all these issues led either to excessive costs or to reduce sales. For instance, in the case of KFC, a change in their supplier of the chicken led to the close of almost half of the restaurants in the UK during 2018. Also for other retailers, in the case of HD Supply, the change in terms of the supply chain configuration for an automated warehouse led to significant difficulties in scaling the operation in this warehouse, which led to delays in the order fulfillment of stores. And also an example in the beverage industry with White Claw not being able to produce enough to meet the surge in the demand that they faced during 2019. So all these cases, they show that even though companies are very aware of the operations planning, in many cases, difficulties happen. And these difficulties, or even though the variables that are affected at the end of the day are costs and sales, they arise from different root causes. So some of them are cases that the design of the supply chain was not the most appropriate, and others had difficulties in trying to establish the way that operations should be carried during the next periods. So this is important because it's important to understand that operations planning is a vast field. And it's a vast field that covers different time horizons and different scopes in the decisions and also different stakeholders in the companies. So starting with the range, so within operations planning, we might have decisions that tackle the long term, and the long term here by meaning decisions that we take once every year, for instance, once we do, for instance, the sales budget, the operations budget for the next year, once we define which is the product range that we are going to operate during the year. There are also decisions that cover the midterm, so they are fed by the long-term decisions. And in the midterm, what we want to do is to define what is the best plan to do the operations for the next months, for instance. And then we have short-term decisions that are taken daily or weekly, and they are more concerned about the execution and the short-term planning of the operations. Meaning that this vast range of decisions that have to be taken in the supply chain also involve different stakeholders, as I mentioned previously, ranging also from the commercial department, planning and operations. So they are not exclusive from the operation side because many of their inputs and also outputs affect each other. More than that, it's also important to understand that the nature of the decisions taken in each one of these steps is important to understand what type of analytics we need in each one of these steps. And to clarify this point, let me introduce an example in the area of asset management. Imagine that you want to operate a wind farm, meaning that we have a set of wind turbines that you want to maximize the revenue that you obtain from them. You can start collecting data on these wind turbines, for instance, about their availability. You start by storing all this information in a database and try to assess what has been the availability of these wind turbines. When we are doing this type of analysis, we are talking about the domain of descriptive analytics. So descriptive analytics is concerned about understanding what has happened. If we improve the way we are collecting data for this particular wind farm, they introduce a set of variables that can somehow explain the availability of these wind turbines. So this type of variables can be very diverse, but it can be, for instance, the model of the wind turbines, the type of terrain, the wind distribution over time, etc. Once you start adding these variables to your analysis and try to somehow correlate the availability of the wind turbines with these variables, we are trying to understand why did the availability took some value. And in this type of analysis, we are in the domain of diagnostic analytics. So both these two, so descriptive analytics and diagnostic analytics, are concerned about what happened in the past. So we are looking always backwards to the past. When we enter the field of predictive analytics, we want to somehow extrapolate, based on the data that we have collected, what will happen in the future. For instance, in this case, what will be the availability of these wind turbines in the next period. So based on the past behavior of these wind turbines and also on the variables that can explain this type of behavior, we want to predict the future availability of the wind turbines. Up until now, we are only analyzing data. Even though with predictive analytics, we are giving insights to the manager of this wind farm, we are not taking action. And to take action, we need to enter in the field of prescriptive analytics. So in the area of optimization, which will tell us what should we do under different circumstances. For instance, in this case, it could be based on a certain prediction of the availability of the wind turbines. what should be the best maintenance schedule for those wind turbines in order to maximize our revenues or to minimize the cost that we might face with these actions. And the last step in the maturity of the analytics is when we can do all these steps that we are describing previously in such a way that we can transform the way the decisions are made. For instance, in this case, would be to create, instead of a condition-based or time-based maintenance, try to enter into the predictive maintenance policies and try to anticipate what can happen in the future to define the best action in the present. So when we cross these two decisions that we can tackle in operations planning and the type of methods that you can use in analytics, we have come to the conclusion that on one end, we have the adoption of analytics methods in practice when we are talking about very specific problems that need to be solved in the operational context. Okay, so for instance, if you want to schedule production, or if you want to define what are the best routes for distribution, they are specific softwares that tackle this issue, this type of problems with analytical methods. On the other end, on the other extreme, when we talk about more strategic type of decisions, traditionally business science lead to what we call satisfying results, or at least this type of decisions can be framed in such a way that decision makers are comfortable in taking these decisions based on these frameworks. What we have noticed is that there is an important gap between the strategic type of decisions and the operational type of decisions, where on one end, business sense is not enough, and the operational solutions that exist are not able to properly address the challenges. And this decision gap concerns tactical decisions. And in this type of tactical decisions, we like to use that approach to recommend a possible business solution or, for instance, validate some solution from the with based on business science, but can be validated using advanced data analytic methods. So what type of problems are we talking about? For instance, we can be talking about the plant layout, the production, the product range that we should serve to our clients, the transportation flows within the supply chain. So all these type of decisions are decisions that are made periodically. They are not made too often, but they are made periodically by senior managers. But what we have noticed is that they use limited analytical capabilities, and that can boost the type of the solutions that that companies do in this type of tactical problems can be boosted by using analytics. But we also have noticed that there is a reason why this gap exists. And the reason why this gap exists is mainly coming from five major challenges. One is that in practice, operations planning decisions in this type of scope in tactical in the tactical level are often made in a disconnected way. So we, for instance, plan production, and then a separate team plans the transportation, and another separate team plans the purchasing. And when we take these decisions in silos, we have limited understanding of what are going to be the impacts between the different decisions for the different functions. Moreover, we also noticed that many times these decisions, when we want to apply more advanced methods, they are often limited to the use of manual solutions. So planners have to come up with the plan entirely by hand, or they are somehow supported by tools, but that require frequent planners' intervention. So this time-consuming phase of developing the solutions also enables the use of analytics in practice. Another important challenge that emerged to use this type of approaches in practice for this challenge is that they often are reactive. So when we are planning operations, we are many times treating the symptoms and not actually treating the root causes behind the supply and demand mismatch. And only by attacking these sources, we can somehow solve these problems more frequently. Also, there is a low fit to reality. What do we mean by a low fit to reality? So when we are tackling this type of tactical problems, we need to understand what is the adequate level of granularity in our decisions in such a way that the outputs of our plans are accurate representations of reality. And often these decisions in this type of in practice are made on a top-down approach that neglects important details in the solutions. And finally, we have seen in practice that these decisions are often tackled in a static and unreliable way. What do we mean by this? So we take this decision once and we don't revise it periodically to understand if what have been the inputs at a certain point are the ones that are present currently, or if we need to somehow update our decisions along time. So to try to overcome these five major challenges, we need to somehow transform.
Luis, let me just add detail here, because I think that these five challenges that we have here are even worse nowadays, because as you know, you have more and more data available. And even though we have more and more data available, because of these five drawbacks, we are not taking advantage of that information. So with more data, we were able to make or to use that information to make plans with more detail or more granularity. So in fact, these five dimensions are even more concerning nowadays, because this information is more available to decision makers.
Yes, and to try to overcome these challenges, what we need is to try to embed analytics within the business processes. So analytics is not something that we do outside the business process, but it needs to be incorporated in the current business process. And to do this, we are going to introduce a set of enablers that can afterwards be leveraged by business use cases of this type of approach. So what we mean by enablers are a certain set of conditions that need to be present in order to transform the way that businesses plan their operations. On one side, you have to have integrated and systematized business processes with clear indicators that allow us to validate the way we are going to develop the solutions. Another important point is that we need to have proper data management procedures in order to collect and store the necessary data to perform this type of analysis. And then, of course, you need to have a pool of methods that can create the solutions for this type of challenges. And this can be, as I mentioned previously, from descriptive analytics to prescriptive analytics. So from machine learning, optimization, and also digital tools. But all this set of enablers, they are not sufficient to transform the way businesses can transform their operations. To have actual impact in companies, we need to have use cases that support the use of this type of analytics. And we are going to explore in our webinar three use cases, one regarding the production strategy, another one regarding the creation of budgeting, zero-based budgeting, and the final one regarding resource planning. So entering in the first use case, the production strategy, what we would like to understand is how to ensure that our service levels for the clients are state of the art while maintaining a cost efficient structure. We know that nowadays customers are becoming more demanding, and we are not just talking about end customers. Also, companies between each other are becoming more demanding. Forcing many times the service levels that are very demanding. So an important decision that has to be made under this context is the way we are going to plan the production for our items. And what we mean by production strategy is that we have many options in the way we are going to supply this demand. On one hand, we can have an option of supplying demand of our customer orders directly from final product stock. So type of strategy that we call here make to stock. So we produce in advance based on forecasts, and the available stock is used to supply the customer orders. The other opposite is producing only to orders. So once the customer order enters our company, we start to produce the final items. So this will take a longer production lead time. So it will take longer to supply the orders from our customers. In the between, we can also have strategies that we call here make to pack, where we produce until a certain stage in our production process, and we only deploy the remaining phase, so what we call here the packaging, once the customer order arrives our time. Although we have many alternatives, what is important to understand is that potentially within the same company, we might have products that are more tailored for a make-to-stock type of strategy, and others that are more tailored for a make-to-order or make-to-pack strategy. What is important here is that we can somehow model the costs. So on one end, we have stock costs. The more make-to-stock products we have, the more stock we'll need to carry in order to supply our customer's order. And on another end, if we do only make-to-order, we have increased production costs because we are often changing production at our production lines, but we also have service costs because we are taking longer to supply the demand, the orders from the clients. To take this decision, we need to somehow balance these two types of costs and understand what is the ideal mix within the company for this type of strategy, production strategy. And to do so, two important variables that we need to address are the sales volume of our products and also the number of orders that the product has. We came up here with the representation of a possible situation where we have the first set of products where we call the sales champions, those that have high volume with a high number of orders. These are the type of products that are often more favorable to a make-to-stock policy. On another extreme, we have products with low sales volume, a low number of orders, what we call here the lone wolves that are more tailored for a make-to-order policy. And in between, the ones that we call make-to-pack are those that represent large families, meaning that products between themselves share some common components and that can profit from having a make-to-pack type of policy where we reduce the uncertainty of planning just to one final product and take advantage of this inventory pooling that we can have between the different products in these large families. So we have applied this type of analytical methods in a cable manufacturer. So this cable manufacturer struggled to excel in their service level. So the cable manufacturer essentially have two types of major clients. We have clients that are distributors that retail the products from this cable manufacturer, and they also have utilities that often either with the extension in their cables and lines or their renewal of their cable and lines needs this type of products. So we develop an analytical method to depict the way that operations occur in the shop floor, and then understand what was the most suitable strategy for each product by trading off the impact in the throughput rate of our production, the facility, and also the service that we can provide to the end customers. And at the end of the day, having the same investment in the final inventory, we could increase the on-time in full service level by more than 35 percentage points. So now I will leave Danielle to present you the two other cases.
Thank you, Luis. So another relevant topic that we decided to bring here today is the budgeting operation, and the budgeting operation is very relevant in terms of operations planning in various domains. We can talk about production, logistic, procurement activities. So when we are trying about the budgeting, we are when we are talking about budgeting, we are indeed talking about the planning of these resources for the next year or for the next periods. But as you can see in the slide, we are calling this approach zero-based budgeting instead of budgeting, basically because past budgeting methods are nowadays not good enough to address the complexity of our world. And as you may know, maybe for experience, in the past, you look at past data, aggregate data, and then you apply some growth rates or decreasing rates to estimate the budget for the next year. When we are talking about a zero-based approach, we are talking, on the other hand, on an exercise that is done from scratch. So you somehow make a twist here, you reverse the exercise. So you start by planning each one of your resources and to optimize each one of your resources. And then you build the budget upon the utilization and the optimization of each one of these resources. And basically, in terms of methodology, when we are talking about the application of a zero-based approach, there are here two first steps that are very relevant so you can be prepared to address this new approach. And of course, you need to start by addressing your budgeting operation. You need to start by mapping the interactions, the activities, each one of the resources, as I was saying. And then you need to have here an analytical machine that provides you the flexibility to somehow assess these scenarios, to somehow assess the occupation of each one of your resources, and then to build budgets on top of this information. And then in the circle here, you see the most important part of the zero-based budget approach, because you started by mapping the operation, you then applied here optimization model, and then you are able to somehow enter in a what-if budgeting process in which you can define a scenario, you can automatically generate a plan, an optimized plan, and then to evaluate this scenario using several KPIs and several perspectives. And then you can go through this loop as many times as you want until you define a global budget that is holistically good for your company. Once you have decided on the budget you are trying to follow in the next year, you enter in the implementation side of the topic, and then practices like sales and operations planning and the rolling planning are important, so you can revise this budget more frequently and have an updated or a readjusted budget that can somehow take into account the most recent information of your company.
Daniel, can I cut you there just for a second?
Yes, Daniel.
Just thinking about the current scenario we're all in now in 2020, and looking back into the effort that the companies placed on their budgeting exercise, probably done in late 2019, what would you advise them to do now? I mean, the longer they had invested in the budgeting exercise, the more regrets they probably have now, because the world completely changed. So what would your advice be for most of the companies who are currently looking at the budget that they built for this year and probably not recognizing it anymore and eventually building a new one? What would you say?
I would say that given the happenings of the last or the occurrences of the last months, I would say that it is time for us to build a new budget for the next month, so you can take most recent information to build a new plan. Of course, you can some assumptions and some guidances and some strategic lines you have defined previously maybe applicable now, but the data and the predictions and the forecasts on the demand, for instance, are completely different now. So now it is more than ever time to loop through this circle and to somehow define a different scenario, look into an automated generated plan, an optimal plan, given the constraints that we are facing now, and then to evaluate these plans and to decide whether you are going to make a transition or change your strategy, your operational strategy and your operational planning, or not. So I would say that it is important now. I would say that more than ever, nowadays you should go through this loop in a more recurrent fashion, so you can adjust to this new reality more rapidly.
Daniel, let me just add that so this situation that we live currently is the perfect scenario to apply this type of approach in such a way that more than trying to have the most cost-efficient solution, what we actually want is a robust plan. So a plan that can adapt to different scenarios in such a way that the outcomes are always favorable. So what we are trying here is not just looking for the best potential solution, but also for a solution that can cope with different different scenarios and that can cope with the change that we observe every day.
Okay. This next slide, I think that will make the things and these thoughts more tangible, because here we have the inner loop or the virtuous loop I was talking to you in the past or in the last slide. And as you can see, when we are talking about create alternative scenarios, we are indeed talking about combining, for instance, different operations strategies or different demand projections. And given, for instance, COVID-19 problem and the consequences that this pandemic is causing in our operations, you can, in these demand projections, indeed try different combinations and generate a set of scenarios. And for each one of these scenarios, you can then generate an optimal plan. And in this optimal plan, you will optimize production inventory over time and every decision you may imagine and every decision that is indeed relevant for your business. And optimize these plans are followed naturally by the evaluation of these KPIs, these or other KPIs that are relevant. The notion and the idea of robustness, as Luis was presenting, is one of the KPIs, is one of the indicators that could be on the basis of this analysis. But another relevant dimension nowadays, but not only nowadays, but in the past, this idea of rolling planning is appearing, because imagine you are in October, November, December, you are generating the budget for the next year. So you are indeed making a plan for the next 12 to 15 months. But 1 month or 2 months is ahead, you have more information that you could provide somehow to the initial budget you have generated. So you could make one revision, two revisions, or as many revisions as you want. So you can take into account the most recent information, readjust your budget. And another benefit is the extended horizon that you are having while you are doing this, because you do not need to wait for the next year's budgeting operation or exercise to plan the operations of your company. So if you are making constant and rolling revisions, you are able to somehow plan 12 months in advance. And indeed, this can be an advantage regarding overall planning and aggregate planning and budgeting and planning the operations of your company.
Are you advising, Daniel, that the amount of effort that you place in the initial budgeting for the next 15 months could be not so high if you set up the fast feedback loop on top of current results and review it, let's say, every quarter?
Yes, if you are somehow revising this information more frequently, you do not enter in that arduous task of getting all the information, collecting the information, define the criteria and specifications. So I would say that making this effort more frequently somehow would make the task less arduous. Yes.
Okay. Let me also just add that so budgets serve different purposes, of course, and although for some of these purposes, this initial estimation is quite important, especially if, for instance, you need to do a financial plan for the next year for the company. In many other cases, in terms of operations, this replan that you do every time you revise the budget also brings this important information that Daniel was sharing, and the increased visibility that you can have also for increasing the horizon every time you do it is also very important sometimes when you have to take the decisions that are to be operationalized in a longer lead time.
Yes. Just to somehow give you a more clear idea about this scheme of zero-based budgeting, of course, it will help if you have somehow a platform that could help you to generate these plans in a more user-friendly fashion. And in this sense, we have, I was trying to play a video, but I'm here with a problem. Okay, it's working now. Okay, so in this sense, it helps if you can resort to a platform in which you can parameterize all this information, define the cost of your production, of your logistical activities, to define the capacity constraints of your supply chain, and then you can create these runs. And as we were talking before and presenting before, you can have as many runs as you want for each one of these scenarios. In the end, the goal is that you can detail and analyze these plans with more granularity than in a past or traditional budgeting operation. But the life and the analytical application of these concepts to operations planning is not only a question of budgeting. So we are trying and are we are bringing here another topic. There is resource planning in a more broad sense, because in between this exercise of budgeting and more aggregate planning, I'm always trading off different objectives, different and conflicting objectives. And it is important that somehow we can have some analytical head in this process.
Sorry to cut you again. Before moving into resource planning, let me just place a quick question that was placed by the audience, which relates to your zero-based budgeting tool.
Okay.
How dynamic and easy was it to adapt to new circumstances?
The zero-based budgeting practice applicable, or your
zero-based budgeting tool, which you've...
Yes. In this specific case. Okay, in this specific case, it's a very good question, because this platform and this system was used to assess different scenarios short after the pandemic emerged. So the company, in case, have defined several demand projections, and have for each one of the factories defined here different scenarios for the next month. So I will say that this is a flexible approach that in times like this can be useful, so you can plan different circumstances.
Daniel, let me just say that you can play both with the demand projections, okay? So you can define what are your demand estimates, but also you can play with capacity. So having different operating strategies lead to different capacity throughout time, and understand what is the best trade-off between these demand scenarios and the capacity that you are going to plan for the next period.
Yes.
And if you change KPIs to be optimized or add additional constraints? Is it automatic, or do you have to reconfigure everything again under including the underlying algorithms behind it?
So the way that it operates, so after the initial process mapping, so all the relevant constraints are already mapped. Sometimes what you need to define is the level where these constraints are nowadays and in the future. So it's a more a question of parameterization of the platform itself than of trying to go again into the analytical model.
Okay. Yes.
Going back through the presentation and this topic of resource planning, here we are not talking about, as I was saying, of budgeting. We are talking about resource planning on a going basis. And as you can imagine, and this is the life of the operations managers of, nowadays, of our days, to be always trading off different objectives. And these objectives can be, for instance, as you can see here on the left side of the slide, inventory level, service level, and capacity that are in nature conflicting and that are in nature needs to be considered altogether. For instance, if you, as a company, you want to increase the service level you provide to your customers, you may need to increase the inventory levels. And to increase the inventory levels in turn, you will need more capacity to produce the additional inventory, but you may not have that capacity free, so this can become very difficult to anticipate and to manage. So it would be useful if you have somehow a simulator or a digital twin of your factory so you can anticipate these constraints, okay? And the digital twin modeling is in fact an analytical approach to this topic of resources planning that are not trying to generate optimal plans, but are trying to give the user that is trying to give to the user flexibility to assess different configurations in terms of the managing of these dimensions altogether. And to implement a digital twin model, you need to follow a methodology that is composed by four main steps. I will say that, of course, you need to start by understand your current processes, to make your current processes. This is the basis of the work. Then you need to apply the analytical expertise to build a digital twin that perfectly depicts your factory or your warehouse, your operation. And then once you are able to define this digital twin, you may assess different resource utilization schemas and you may reach an improved version of your current operation. Once you define and you get to a final conclusion of this improved version of your resource utilization, you are able to implement this in the real world. But the difference is that you have assessed several combinations in a risk-free environment, traditional changes or traditional approaches to these resource utilization differences were not so risk-free in the sense that you are trying and then you are implementing that and then you are evaluating the results. Using a digital twin, you are capable of anticipating the impacts that may appear during this process. Just to make this again a little more tangible, we decided to bring here some use cases. These are not exhaustive, or this is not exhaustive in the sense that digital twins, as I was saying, are very flexible and are appropriate to be used in resource planning. But for example, imagine that you have a production plan and that you have a digital twin of your factory, okay? So you can assess different properties of this production plan and to evaluate the results. For instance, you can change the orders quantities, the order sequence, the minimum lot sizes you are deciding to produce and to evaluate the results in service level, production costs, machines, occupation, for instance. Another example could be staff allocation and scheduling. in which you start by having an initial schedule, and then you can change some parameters such as shift duration, overtime rules, allocation rules, and then evaluate again a set of KPIs. Another example could be materials planning, in which you aim to assess the inventory balancing along your entire supply chain, raw materials, work in progress, final goods, and you can use different coverage targets and evaluate the results in terms of service level for your customers, for example. We are bringing here an example, a special example of a project we have in which we have used, in fact, a digital twin to mediate the joint venture between two factories, just to demonstrate to you the flexibility that these models can have. And in this case, I was trying again to, okay, it's already worked. So in this case, we started by depicting, as I was saying, the factory in this model, as you can see on the left side of the slide. This model contains the entire machinery, the throughputs of the machines, the goods flowing throughout the factory. So we were able, first of all, to define here a platform that gives us the confidence to assess different scenarios. And then it was a question of defining alternatives. And when I say defining alternatives, to decide and to choose segments of products that I would want to move from one factory for another, for instance, and to use all these scenarios to assess the economies of scale that might appear, the excess capacity that might appear in the system, the costs of the production orders and so on.
So Daniel, in a sense, the digital twin is like a simulator.
Yes, in the sense it is like a simulator. Yes, it is digital twin because it fully depicts, and the idea behind the concept is that it fully depicts a real system, a real factory, a real warehouse.
To simulate different scenarios. To help you simulating different scenarios.
Yes, right?
And also helps in a very important topic that Daniel already mentioned, that I'm going to stress, that is the possibility to test in a risk-free environment different alternative ways of operating the system. So this avoids the trial and error stage that often companies do when they test pilots within their facilities. So by using this type of models, these digital twins, you can do these pilots virtually and understand what are the major impacts that will have in the operation of your facilities, and assess all this without having to change the actual operation of the plant.
Yep.
So by mapping this, we can validate potential thousands of scenarios for the operation.
I think you briefly mentioned it, but how does this take into account the movement of goods within the factory?
How does the model account for the movement? You need to define, somehow you apply a layout of the factory inside the simulator. So then you might also get to the point in which you define the routes and the distance between two machines, for instance.
Okay.
So you can define the distance, and then you define for each machine, for example, the orders you need to process on that machine based on past information of orders. You define a queue, and then you can simulate all these moves between machines with a very high level of detail. That's the idea of this approach.
Daniel, let me bring also another example. For instance, we have done this in retail warehouses, where we were mainly concerned about the possibility that when pickers move around the corridor,
yes,
so their interaction might affect the productivity. So the more they cross each other, the less productive they are, or for instance, they are they are in the middle of the corridor doing their picking operations, and another picker wants to pass and is not able to do it. So we have done this type of modeling in such a way that we can assess actually the impacts of very detailed operations within this type of system.
Okay. Yes. So just to end up our presentation, we would like you to invite you, and you have received in your invitation for the webinar, to fill our base analytics assessment, in which you will have the opportunity to assess your business analytics maturity, not only on the topics that we have seen today of processes and operations, but also on another functions of the company, such as strategy and organization, customer and sales, or people and technology. And I would like to thank you for watching our presentation today. And I do expect that this presentation has showed you that our goal is indeed to empower every decision with analytics, and that when we apply these techniques to operations planning, there are a lot of potentialities that can be studied and potentiated using these approaches.
Thank you. Thank you, Luis. Thank you, Danielle. I tried to place most of the questions that our attendees left us on the Q&A and on the chat, but I didn't cover them all. Going back to your initial point of the silos, Luis, there's a question on how do you manage to break silos or bend silos within organizations that are very siloed oriented, to the point that even data might not be completely transparent and shared throughout the organization. And in a sense, this question is maybe not too different from another one which we have, which is, what about change management? A lot of these projects fail, not really due to technical difficulties, but more related to the adoption within the companies. Any tips on both of them?
So this is a very interesting question, and
it's not mine. It's from the audience.
From our audience, and it's something that we face almost every day. So going back a little bit in our presentation, I presented these three use cases that we call Blue Levers. So they are built to support decisions within the companies, but we also have the enablers. And the enablers are not only, as we've seen, data and the analytic methods, but all the business processes. So it's mandatory that all these techniques are applied within the context of business processes. So often what we need to do to apply this more transformational project is also to systematize in different ways the business processes and the business interaction between stakeholders. Of course, this requires a lot of change management from the legacy process to the new process. But often what we try to do is to try to show gradually the benefits of adopting the new processes. So somehow starting by small steps, so small changes within the current processes, and gradually introduced more degrees of freedom in terms of the operations planning. Okay, so by doing this, let's say, path from more slight changes within the current process until largest changes and more profound changes, we try to also monitor this change management throughout this.
Yes, I will say
this
is not different from another change management practices and processes that you need to apply when you want to change something in the organization. So I will say that you need to have the same commitment, the same degree of effort, but if the company believes that this will work, I think that it will succeed, of course.
Okay, let me change back to the mainstream subject that has been covering our lives for the last 3 months, and place you both a question on where did we fail? I mean, where did analytics fail to predict this very large black swan that we faced on the beginning of the year? What is there to learn from what's happened that we were, as a society, as most organizations, basically unable to predict and unable to react fast enough?
Yeah, it's a very interesting question, you know, but let me go back to the final comment of your question. Of course, we can say that analytical methods failed to predict this once in a lifetime. Actually, I think it's once every century that we have a pandemic. But more important is that companies that already embed this type of approaches within their organizations are better suited to react faster to these changes in the context, meaning that if we have this type of techniques to respond faster, to react faster to the changes in the context, we are able to adapt faster than companies that don't have this type of skills. I think the emphasis is more on having this type of techniques to adapt and to react than to predict something that often is extremely hard to predict.
Okay. We're basically touching the limit time that we had defined for the session. Let me just go to one last question that was placed here regarding what kind of resistance do you face? Resistance or not, do you face from employees on your customers, on your clients, when you start automating some of these processes that technology and analytics helps to treat? I mean, do you see some resistance? Do you see some pushback, or on the other hand, are they enthusiastic about the change? What's your experience?
I will say that generally people are enthusiastic about the change. And I think that people understand that this is beneficial in the sense that we are not replacing their work. We are giving them a good head so they can perform the tasks and spend their time on validating solutions and not on generating solutions. So I think that's somehow a twist on the functions that these people need to understand to adopt these tools.
More on looking into the data rather than preparing the data to be looked at.
Yes. Okay.
Yes, and also many times supporting the decision. So we are not making the decision by the people that are required to make the decision. We are only supporting them in such a way that they are more comfortable the final decision that they take.
Okay. I mean, it's 7:05. I think it's the good enough timing for us to close the session. We've covered most of the questions that were placed. One or two which you could not cover, but we'll try to get in touch with the attendee and answer them by email. It was a pleasure being with you this afternoon. Thank you so much, Louise and Danielle, for your presentation. I think the subject that was under discussion is of great interest, regardless of the timing that we're living in, which it only reinforces the importance of analytics. I hope you all had a pleasant time, and I thank you all for participating and hope you stay safe and well. Bye.